the show. But for now, let's concentrate on the rock and roll side, and the music is particularly special this week. We're all fairly knocked out, I'd have said. Please hoot like barn owls for the haunting, mesmerising, rocking Nanci Griffith. Oh, yeah. My microphone wasn't up during that. I was singing. Okay. This is a spooky, ghostly Halloween rock and roll special. And while you were sitting in with the band earlier on, you said, oh, I've seen ghosts quite recently, you said. That can't go without passing. What's the story?
Well, I haven't actually seen a ghost, but I heard a ghost. There's a hotel here in London where mm-hmm. I stay, and it has a notorious ghost that's supposed to have been a pilot during World War II who landed on the top of the building.
Did you know this in advance?
No, I didn't know in advance. When it first happened to me, the first night I stayed there, the doors to my television cabinet opened and closed all night long and kept me awake, and I was so jet-lagged that I just kind of, you know, dismissed it.
And, no.
But then he set on me, and that really disturbed me.
Huh?
He sat on me, and
who sat on you?
The you know, entity, whatever it is, it's in the hotel. He sat on me, and it was like having covers tucked so tightly around you that you couldn't move.
Yeah. Now people are going to say it's one of those goofball Americans again with their crazy theories. Shirley MacLaine, the whole bit.
Shirley MacLaine would have tried to talk to it. I just said, I'm a Texan. I just said, look, I'm jet lagged. I'm tired. Not tonight, okay?
Are you susceptible to this kind of thing? Do you believe? Is that it?
I really don't. You know, I've never really thought about it too much. But the next night at the hotel, there was nothing. But the night after that, things started just flying around my room, and I didn't know what it was that was flying around the room until in the morning, and whatever it was had taken all of the my like electrical adapters for, you know, hair rollers and things like that, and just that's what had been whizzing by me, and they were behind. I had to move furniture and find them and find my hair rollers and stuff. Didn't hit me with them. I guess it was probably because I said no that first night or whatever. I don't know.
You see, I mean, all right, taking it to face value, I mean, shouldn't you be more wigged out than you are? I mean, you're taking it rather well.
Well, I just thought it was interesting. I mean, you know, hotels are really boring when you spend your entire life in hotels. And if you can stay in a hotel where there's something actually happening, you know, I think it's great.
Given that the appeal is global now, and I was saying earlier on that one of the things you've robbed me of, I used to like introducing people to Nanci Griffith, and, you know, I'll play Five and Dime, and they say, who's that? And I just say, Nanci Griffith. But now, of course, everyone knows you, and you can't do that anymore. Did you plan on that? Because when all said and done, your act is, and what you do is down home, and it's a simple type of musicianship as opposed to the complicated Rick Wakeman who's coming on later on. Did you plan on conquering the world like this? And
well, what I planned on doing is basically I'm a songwriter, you know, and what I planned on doing with my life is writing songs. I wanted to grow up and be Harlan Howard or Jimmy Webb, you know. I didn't want to ever be a performer, and I played rhythm guitar and sang backup for so many people in bands that I ended up getting a record deal and making records, and then, you know, that did happen slowly. It happened by, you know, one person telling their second cousin, and their second cousin went home and told their uncle, you know. And
who told the poltergeist, who just told everyone in the hotel in the end of it. What was when was the first time? Do you remember your very first performance? The first time you got on stage and thought, well, here we go, and started strumming and on your own?
Yes, because someone had canceled at a little bar. My parents were beatniks. And they had
what do you mean?
My parents were very unusual, and they were very odd, and they had a lot of very odd friends. And one of their friends owned a club, a folk club, cabaret in Austin, Texas, where I'm from. And there was a cancellation, and I was called in to come in and play. I was 14, and nobody came. And but I made $11.
$11.
$11.
But it was for the love of it, wasn't it?
Yes, and my mother and father listened very patiently.
Yeah, $11. Yeah. In the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, Nanci Griffith, right? Want to get this? It's the best of Nanci Griffith for just 12 English pounds. But it lies. It's actually the second best. The best is being in the same room. So let's grab some. Here's Nanci Griffith.
Thank you, Dan.
Now she drove away from Salt Lake City to the California coastline. She hit the San Diego freeway doing 60 miles an hour. She had a husband on her bumper. She had five restless children. And she was singing as sweet as a monkey and bird in that 40 gun on the end. She is a soldier of the air. Yes, straight from the bosom of the Mormon church with the boys lying around. Cruising along in that 40 gun on the end. Now her husband was a gambler. He was a soldier. She is a soldier of the edge. Yes, straight from the bosom of the Mormon.